So today I'll talk about these two topics, cooperative game theory and the Shapley Valley model. Now, the concepts themselves are a bit complicated, but I have simplified them with the hope that they'll be easy to understand for all of us. So this is sort of in relation to what we were talking about last week on the Markov chain modeling. So if you remember last week, I explained the Markov chain model, and we also saw how the Markov chain model can be applied to B2B marketing attribution. So, over the past 2 3 weeks, we've been covering this concept of B2B marketing attribution, that is, when different media or advertising channels are involved, and we get a revenue out of all those advertisements that we make, and then how do we attribute that revenue to the different media channels? So that is what attribution is all about. And the Markov chain model we saw last week is one technique which helps you to attribute those different, attribute the revenue to those different marketing channels. And the cooperative game theory and Shapley Valley model is another technique which helps you to do the same thing. So, to give you an overview about the technique, what this does is it equitably distributes the payoffs of a game among players who may have unequal contribution to the payoff. Now, payoff, you can think of it as a reward. Okay? So, if you so if a collective group of people do certain activity and they get a certain reward, then how do you allocate that reward equitably among each of those people? So, equitably is a fair distribution. It's not, so just note that I have not used the word equal. So, equal is different from equitable. Equitable is to say that we allocate the reward in proportion to the contribution of each person. Okay, so that is what this Shapley value basically does. It is a measure of a player's average marginal contribution to each coalition. Now, coalition is nothing but the different subgroups who are involved in that, in doing that particular activity. Now, another thing to note is that the payoff or the reward can also be substituted with cost. So, let's say a group of people get together, do some activity which incurs a particular cost, right? And that cost can also be allocated to the different players involved in the activity. So that depends on the situation which you're dealing with. And drawing a parallel with the attribution modeling scenario that we were discussing last week, then each player in the game will be the each campaign or each marketing channel. Okay. And by the term coalition, we are talking about the different interactions or pathways between those channels. So last week we discussed, right? The customer will first click on the Google ad, and then he will watch some banner ad in some other website, and then finally he makes a purchase. So that is what we call as an interaction, or going from one particular channel to another. So that is what we call as a coalition in the Shapley value and game theory context.
One quick question, Sai.
Yes, sir.
See, when you say payoff reward can be substituted with cost, you mean to say that, okay, so basically one of the players can be a cost instead of being getting a reward, is it? I'm just trying to understand and clarify a bit on that point.
So it's not just for one of the players, it's for the entire game, basically. So for example, here we
Okay,
have
okay,
seen.
okay. Got it, got
Yeah.
it, got it. Okay, so who is incurring how much of a cost? You know, the
Exactly, yes.
attribution, but cost-wise. Okay,
Yes.
understood, understood. Okay,
So it could
yeah,
either be a revenue attribution or a cost attribution.
Got it. Okay, understood, understood. Clear. Yeah, thank you.
And so certain basic terminology involved in this concept. So N denotes the set of all players, or so in the attribution modeling context, it denotes the set of all marketing channels involved in the marketing campaign. And then S is a particular subset of channels that we take. And then there is also a characteristic function called as V. Now, if you're looking into the formula and everything, these are the terminology that you will see. For today's session, rather than going into too much theory, I've got an example which I hope will explain the concept better. But before we go into the concept, we just look a bit more into, I mean, before we go into the example, we just look a bit more into the concept. So,
Sai, I need some help in understanding the characteristic. What did you mean by characteristic there? Characteristic function.
So this is a function which is used to model the or which is used to calculate the Shapley value.
Okay.
So this the formula for calculating the Shapley value will include this characteristic function, which is a function of the players or the channels involved and the subset of the channels which we consider.
Okay. Is it typically denoted with a small v?
Yes, at least in the research that I was doing, in the materials that I went through, it was denoted by a small v.
Okay, got it. Okay. Please proceed.
Yeah. So, a little bit on the concept of game theory. Basically, this is a theoretical framework for social situations among competing players. Okay. And to be more precise, it is a decision-making theory. Okay. So there are independent actors or competing actors in a strategic setting, and with a system involving these types of actors, how do we make the most optimal decisions? Okay, or in other words, how do we model complex human behavior? Okay, so you are given a situation, several actors or several people are involved in that situation. Okay, and there are elements of revenue, cost, and everything involved. Okay, so what is the optimal decision that you make? Okay, so that decision could be something that will help you maximize your revenue or minimize your cost. Okay, so that is what we call as a game situation, in which there are several decision makers and each of them wants to optimize their results. So by optimizing, we mean maximizing the revenue or minimizing the cost. In fact, this is similar to what we have in a field of study called as linear programming or operations research. If you have done your MBA or if you have studied mechanical engineering, you may be familiar with the term. So this is what we call as the game theory. And then there is something called as cooperative game theory, which is a slight bit of an extension on the game theory concept, where groups of players called coalitions. So in the previous slide, I said that coalition is an interaction or pathway, right? So this groups of players is what we call as coalitions. And these are the primary units of decision making, okay? So why do we call this cooperative? Because the decision is not conventional game theory concept, the decision is not being made by a single person, it is made by a group of persons, which we call as a coalition. So when a group of persons interact with each other, what decision making activity do they perform? So that is what the cooperative game theory deals with, and we are saying it may enforce cooperative behavior. I got an example to illustrate this, but this is the basic concept of game theory and cooperative game theory. Any questions here until now?
So is cooperative game theory more applicable for our scenario? I'm just trying to understand why it is.
Yes, Chaitanya. So the way we calculate, for example, if you take the marketing attribution scenario, right? The way we attribute the revenue to each of those channels would involve us considering the combination effect of multiple channels involved. So we take different combinations of different channels, see what would be their corresponding effect, and that is one of the parameters which goes into calculating the Shapley value. And by calculating the Shapley value for each individual channel, we correspondingly allocate the proportion of the revenue to each channel. So this is one part of the Shapley value calculation.
Thank you. I'm just also trying to understand how is the cooperative piece of it coming into picture. So in a way, a set or a bunch of channels, right? Mm-hmm. Would some of them see? There are some things like, for example, like the YouTube assisting, lead generation, for example,
right?
Because there is a specific YouTube video that answers all the questions, right? So a prospective buyer finds it and then helps the overall, let's say, the marketing puzzle move forward, right? So that is sort of, I understand that it is sort of cooperating with the objective. I'm just trying to understand, how is the model taking that into account? It's sort of that kind of a question.
I've got an example, shall I walk you through that?
Yeah, I think if you feel you're going to come to that little later, it's okay. Is that fine? Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Okay.
I think the example has that, has this concept.
Okay, excellent. Yeah. Perfect. Yeah. Okay, please proceed. Yeah.
So little bit of the about the Shapley value in itself. So it is a solution concept in cooperative game theory, and it was introduced by Lloyd Shapley in 1951, for which he was awarded the Nobel Prize after a very long time in 2012. So again, the concept is many players participate in a game. Now each person has a different skill level. Okay, so since each person has a different skill level, each player has his or her own individual contribution, so that there is the contributions are not equal. Okay, and the Shapley value is a way to distribute the total gains fairly to all the players. Now this is a very simplified version of the formula, and this is where the V or the characteristic function comes in. So formula is like 1 divided by the number of players multiplied by summation of the division between the marginal contribution divided by the total number of contribution excluding a particular player. Now this formula looks a bit complicated, but I got a simpler explanation for this, which I will be going into now. So let me just come back to this slides later. Now let's consider this particular example. Now let's assume this situation: three friends go to a restaurant together. Okay, the total bill comes to 900 rupees. So three friends go and they order certain items from the menu, and the total bill comes to 900 rupees. Okay, now the catch here is that how many items were ordered, it's not like each person consumes the same quantity, right? So each person consumes a different quantity of each item ordered. So equally distributing the 900 rupees among three will be unfair. This is what we typically do, right? When we go to a restaurant as a group of people, we just divide the bill equally amongst ourselves. But in reality, what happens is some people might eat more quantity, some people might eat less quantity. So in that case, how do you make that fair distribution of the total amount? So that is where this Shapley value on the cooperative game theory concept comes in. So we have the following data. Okay, so how much it would cost if each person eats alone, and then how much it would cost if different pair combinations of the three will eat together. So this is the data that we have. I'll just show you what it looks like. It's a very simple example. Okay, so let's look at the table on the left, where we say data available. So first column is the person or the combination. That is to say, if A had gone to the restaurant alone, then the bill amount would be 800 rupees, or he would have eaten for 800 rupees worth. If B had gone to the restaurant alone, he would have eaten for 560 rupees worth. If C had gone to the restaurant alone, he would have eaten for 700 rupees. Similarly, if A and B had gone together, the combined bill for these two persons would be 800. If A and C had gone together, the combined bill for these two would be 850. So similarly, we have for the other combinations as well. So this is where the cooperative aspect comes in. So this is these scenarios, right? So we are saying these two players cooperate in the game, and this is the payoff or the cost that has been incurred. So, does this answer the question, Chaitanya?
So basically, when these two go together, they cooperate, and it would cost this much, right? So that's
yes,
what you're saying.
They incur a cost of 800.
Got it. Okay. Okay. So it is in this way that the cooperation is sort of inbuilt into the model.
Yeah.
Right. It's the data that has to tell basically what the impact of cooperation is.
Yes.
Right. So okay. Got it. Understood. In this case, looks like B doesn't eat much.
Yeah.
Okay.
That would be reflected in the final result we have as well.
Okay.
I'll just walk you through that. So with this base data that we have available, the next step is to calculate the incremental or the marginal payout for each sequence. So by sequence, what we mean is permutations. So just see the fine print here. This is not a combination, this is a permutation. So that is That is, we are considering in each of the sequences that we have here, we are considering all the three players, but we are making different arrangements of, so, you know, if you just go back to your school days memory, the difference between permutation and combination is that combination involves just selection, but permutation involves selection as well as arrangement. Now, in each of these sequences, you select all the three people, and also you arrange those three people in all the different possible ways. So that is what you have here on the in the permutation column. Okay. Now, just look at this column of working, what I put over here. See, for A, B, and C, first value I put is 800, okay? Which means this particular 800. So if A had gone to the restaurant alone, what would be the bill amount incurred? That is what this 800 rupees is all about, okay? Now then, what you consider is, if A and B had gone together, then what would be the total amount incurred for these, by these two people? So A and B, if you see, that is also 800, right? So what you do is, you subtract this 800 from this 800. You just calculate the remaining amount, which is attributable to just B alone. So 800 minus, but since here, like we said, B doesn't seem to eat much, so there's no difference between these two values. So 800 minus 800 gives you zero, okay? And then you calculate the incremental payoff for C. So the total bill amount you see, it's 900, right? What we have here. So 900 minus of the other contributions that you have here. So minus of this 800 plus these two values. So this 800 and 800 will get cancelled, and this would be 900 minus 800, which will give you a value of 100. Maybe I'll explain the next one also, it will be a bit clearer. See the next case. First is individual contribution just for B, okay, which gives a value of 560. Okay. Next is, if B and A go together to the restaurant, the total amount incurred is 800. But out of this 800, 560 is the contribution of just B. So what is the incremental contribution of A? It is 800 minus 560. Okay. And what is the incremental contribution of C? It is total bill amount, 900 minus the total that we have for these two, B and A. Okay. So thereby you get the individual contributions as 560, 240, and 100. Was this clear, or shall I go through a few more instances?
It's clear, Sai.
Okay. So similarly, for each of the other permutations, you calculate the individual contribution or the incremental or the marginal payout for each of the players involved over here. And then what you do is you calculate something called as the average marginal payout. So this is what the Shapley value is basically boils down to. So this average marginal payout, it's just nothing but, so how does this 392 come? I just rounded this number over here a bit, so that's why this total is coming to 901 because of the rounding off. But basically how this is calculated is, for each person, we calculate the average of the individual contributions that we have. So in the first case for A, it is 100, okay? Then it is 240, then 180, and then 150, 180, and 800. So you see, I've taken these six different values, I've calculated the average, dividing them by six, rounding them off, I get a value of 392. Similarly for B, if you see, it is the average of 0, 560, 560, 50, 20, and 50. So this average comes to be 207. Similarly for C, the average comes to be 302. Adding them all up will give you the total of 900. Now since I've rounded it off, the total is a bit on the higher side. Now then, since you have got the Shapley values, you can see that, like we were just discussing, B has the lowest contribution. Okay, so what we saw in the raw data is reflected in the final attribution as well. Okay, and if you just take the percentage share of the Shapley values, then A contributes 44% to the cost, B contributes 23% to the cost, and C contributes the rest 34% to the cost. Okay, so this is what I meant by a by an equitable distribution or a fair distribution. Now, if you were to divide this 900 equally amongst the three, it will be like 33.33%, right? But that is not the right way to do it, because each person has consumed a different quantity of food. That difference in the quantity is what this data reflects, this combinations and the individual contributions data reflect. And based out of that data, we have arrived at the fair distribution of the total cost among the three players involved. Any questions here on this calculation?
Sai, can you just do a ratio of 800 to 560 to 700? What does that number look like?
Ratio as in second?
Just do a quick ratio of 800 is to 560 is to 700. You know, just total it up and do a percentage.
Oh, okay. 800.
Okay. Okay. I think I'm just comparing these percentages with the percentages that you we got this now. Trying to look at. Okay. I know these are different from, I mean, the percentages are different from the, you know, the equal kind of a percentages. But I'm trying to understand. This is just, I'm just trying to instigate a discussion here. Why are these fair? How do we know that these are fair?
I believe that is where this combination effect comes in.
Hmm.
Because when we take them individually, they're a bit different. But when there's that cooperative factor, of course, this is a really simple example. But let us say, in a marketing context, or when there is interaction between multiple ads, or when the customer interacts with multiple ads in a sequence, then I think that combinatorial effect would come into play. That is why we see this difference in the distribution between the individual, when we just take the individual components, and when we take the individual as well as the interactions between the components. That is my opinion. Of course, if there are any other thoughts on this, let's hear them. So, any questions on the calculations? Any doubts? Okay, let me step back a bit here. So, I know we were talking about attribution modeling, right? But there is one other popular application of the cooperative game theory and the Shapley value model. This is called as the airport problem. So this basically deals with how to allocate the cost of building an airport runway to the different airliners who require that runway. Okay, so just to talk about it a little bit more, what they basically do here is the length of the runway is the most important factor that they consider. Okay, so different airlines operate in the airport, different airlines operate different type of aircraft. Okay, so each aircraft would require a runway of a particular length. Okay. So based on the length of the runway which each airliner uses, they calculate the proportional distribution of the cost based on that usage. So this is one other application of the Shapley value model. And in a machine learning scenario, how the Shapley value model and the game theory concept is used is the input features or the independent variables are what we consider as the participants, and the predicted value, which is to say the target or the dependent variable, is the collective payout. Okay, so again drawing a parallel to our attribution modeling scenario, participants will be the different marketing channels involved, and collective payout will be the revenue that we have received as a result of all our marketing campaigns. So in a more complicated situation, this is the series of steps that we would follow. So we calculate the conversion ratio for each channel and path, and then we can calculate something called as the worth for each coalition, and then we calculate the Shapley value using the worth values obtained above. Now the formula for these are a little bit complicated, a little bit different. I have not gone through them in my slides today. And then final steps are similar to what we did. It is just that the way we calculate that Shapley value is a bit different, using that conversion ratio or the conversion probabilities. And then the channel with the highest Shapley value is the best performing channel, and the coalition with the highest Shapley value is the best performing coalition. Now, why do they do this? Is basically they also want to know which combination of channels work best. So for example, let's say you have Facebook, Google and LinkedIn, right? Now it could also be that a combination of a Facebook ad and a LinkedIn ad might come out on top, okay? Rather than using any one particular channel in isolation, using both of them could have the most desirable effect. So in these types of situations, it is the marketer must make a decision to prioritize the combination of channels above using the individual channels. So this is something that is an insight that you would possibly derive in a real-time Shapley value modeling scenario with the real-time data. So certain other points related to attribution modeling. So certain marketing channels can hurt conversions. Okay, so that is to say, certain advertisements or certain media channels might have a detrimental impact on your revenue. So if this is indeed the case, when you calculate the Shapley values for those channels, you will get a negative Shapley value. Okay, so this is one advantage which the Shapley value technique gives. And the disadvantage is that when you have a huge amount of data, when you have so many channels available, then the values must be calculated for every single combination. Okay? So if you have many channels, so typically if your sales cycle is very long and there are too many touch points involved, this method might not be very scalable in that situation. Okay, so this is where we go for an alternative scenario like a Markov chain model. So yeah, that is what I had for today.